Some nice things, and you take it with you in your own time, read it. But she wrote what a nice fellow
Gregory
you were, and
well, I'll take a picture quick, real quick.
Thanks, Gregory.
It's this way.
This way?
Nancy?
Cecilia.
Yes,
hi. How are you?
How are you?
Nice to see you.
Hi,
Troy.
Is Michael here? Did you see Michael?
No. Not yet.
Hello. Glad you're here.
We have some volunteers from the Huntington Theater. We're glad to be back. And there are six of them, and they're...
One in each aisle.
And they're very attractive.
And two upstairs.
All right. So can we hear you for the level of sound?
Mr. Peck, every student has seen To Kill a Mockingbird, and I was wondering if you could relay any particular good experiences that you've had regarding this movie?
Oh, sure, but I'll do it tonight rather than now.
Sound is great.
Yeah, okay. All right, well, near the end of the program, I begin to talk about how I met Mrs. Peck, and then I ask Mrs. Peck to come out on the stage and join me, and she does.
There was one extra ticket. Was there one
Two.
Extra?
She has them. Yeah, no, I've given them both away.
Oh, okay.
Hello, Michael.
How are you?
I'm very well. And you?
I am fine, thank you.
Yeah? Anybody out there?
No. Just me and a couple of my friends, no.
They didn't show up. Well,
yeah. Well. I'm calling my mother. She's going to rush over, but...
That's the way it goes.
Aside from that,
I might have a couple of cousins out there.
You had a couple of cousins last time, I know. Who was it who asked how long the question and answer would be? And they said, oh, 20 minutes. I said, are you kidding? We had 20 minutes from his cousins alone last time.
Tonight is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to meet an American icon as a person. We have known Gregory Peck on film for over 50 years. An esteemed film critic once wrote that somewhere within that man is the best of us. We are going to meet Mr. Peck in just a few minutes, but before we meet the man, let us take one more look at the actor. Here are just some of the highlights from the extraordinary career of Gregory Peck.
You see, General, my people are going to laugh if I fell in deep water. I cannot swim.
That's not so bad, Mr. President. Everyone's about to see that I can't walk on water.
Mr. Tate,
ma.
Say, too late to back out now. I've been sitting back there watching what you've been watching, backwards, of course, and a lot of impressions and a lot of memories, naturally. You saw Robert Duvall in his very first film role there as Boo Radley. I'm particularly struck tonight by the fact that he conveyed so much of tenderness and shyness and courage, all those things without saying a word. It's an acting lesson. I want to talk about Harper Lee a little, the author of To Kill a Mockingbird. And she had never been to Hollywood, but she came to watch us filming on the very first day. And the very first scene was a scene when the children ran down to the end of the block to escort their father back to their little frame house. The boy grabbed the briefcase, and strolling along, we talked over the events of the day.
Good afternoon, Mr. Bowes.
And the camera was following us on what they call a dolly track.
You look like a picture this afternoon.
Well, halfway through the scene, and I'm carrying on chatting with the kids, and I noticed Harper walking behind the camera with her hands behind her back, taking it all in, and I thought I saw some glistening on her cheek. So we finished the scene, and the director said, wonderful, first take, it's a print, that scene will be in the movie, just the way it is. I strolled over to Harper, and I was thinking, well, we had quite an effect on the author, and I felt kind of puffed up about that. And so I said, Harper, did I see something a little shiny on your cheek? She said, oh, Gregory, you've got a little pot belly just like my daddy, she said. I said, Harper, that's great acting. Let's join in now and have a visit. And who would venture forth and ask the first question? Someone? Yes, right here.
Yes, I've got just two quick questions. One, do you have, I'm sure you've been asked this before, do you have a favorite film of yours? I mean, was it your role as Atticus Finch? And the other one I'd like to know about, I miss Audrey Hepburn terribly, and I was wondering if you could comment on what was she like as a person and your associations with her.
I will, and I'll ask everybody that follows if they have a two-part question to ask one part at a time. I might have a senior moment up here.
Let's see you do it.
Sure.
Thank you.
Audrey was so caught up in the moment that she just went bonkers, and that was total spontaneity. About 2 weeks into the film, I called my agent and I said, what are the billing clauses here? What's the official billing? And he said, well, you know, it's Gregory Peck and Roman Holiday, and underneath the title, it's introducing Audrey Hepburn. And I said, George, it will not do. You've got to move her name right up there alongside of mine. He said, Greg, you don't have to do that. He said, I mean, you've worked for this prerogative, and you should be up there alone. I said, George, if Audrey's name is not up there when the movie comes out, I'm going to look like a damn fool. She's going to win the Oscar in this part. And so her name was up there, and she did win the Oscar, and she was a sensation. And after that, everybody lined up to make movies with Audrey Hepburn.
I'm originally from Chile, and my dad gave me a copy of To Kill a Mockingbird many years ago. I loved it then, and I love it now. I've raised a lot of boys, and my youngest is now going to be graduating from law school. And I was hoping that perhaps before tonight is over, you could just autograph a copy of the book.
Sure.
He's a Gregory, too. He's often asked if I named him for you.
Oh, did you?
Yes, I did name him for you.
Well, backstage for you. Yeah.
Here are your friends from Dingle, Mr. Peck.
Hello there.
Pauline Sheehy, this is my husband, your relative.
Yeah, we met you in the Skellig Hotel.
Yeah. We did. We
had
how do you do? We had a good evening, didn't we?
We did a great evening.
Yeah. Hello there.
This is more Dingle.
You came all from London for this evening?
Me, this is, yes.
Did you know? Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, I'm speechless, actually. I don't quite know what to say.
No, tell about your sound.
Well, I've admired you for many years. I wanted to see for myself whether you really are what you appear to be on screen.
Mm-hmm.
You have all the qualities that I admire in a human being.
Mm-hmm.
And tonight has proved to me that that is so, that you are what you appear to be.
Well, I hope so. I hope it isn't all a put-on after all these years.
No, that's what I wanted to find out for myself. I thought, the hell with it. I'm going to blow all my savings and I'm going to come here and see for myself what you're like. And I'm so glad I did. It's been the experience of a lifetime. Thank you very much indeed.
God bless you. Thank you for coming. Well, listen, I got to pick up my odds and ends and bits.
Okay.
Will you put this in your bag, seal?
Mm-hmm.
And off we go. What about those flowers? Maybe we'll give them to that girl from England, shall we? Give them to her.
He'll give them to her.
Hmm. I will. All right. Hello, Riley. Hi, Sandy.
Hey, Riley.
How are you, Riley? I'm glad to see you. I got that family picture.
All right.
Was that 2 years ago?
2 years ago, I think.
The kids look a lot younger.
Yeah.
The kids look smaller.
Hmm?
No, no.
Is that a giant meteor movie?
Yeah.
Well, who was it who prevented it from hitting the earth? Was it Mel Gibson or Bruce Willis?
No. Surprising. It was Robert Duvall.
Boo Radley.
Robert Duvall was the hero.
Boo Radley ended up being an astronaut.
Boo Radley.
Is it time for a little surgery?
One of the things that I've always loved is getting the whole gang together under the same roof.
Look, there's a boat right down there. That looks like a boat full of people. There's another one over there.
The show that I do around the country is not exactly getting back on the stage, but it is in a way because there's a live audience. And when you come out on the stage, you have to keep them interested for an hour and a half. So it's a bit of a challenge, and
okay.
I have a feeling that I'm back where I started, with a live audience.
The best, Greg. Thank you for all of your entertainment.
entertainment.
Thank you kindly.
Over the years, we've enjoyed you tremendously, sir.
Oh, I'm glad to hear it.
It's an honor to meet you.
Thank you. That's
yes,
right.
Sir.
That's
good right. luck tonight. I know you'll be wonderful.
Are you going?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Great.
Hello.
PECK, living legend.
You're great.
Living legend. Well, thanks
so
a lot. Thanks a lot.
Are you?
Thank you kindly.
Wonderful.
Thank you. All right. A lot of my family comes from here. You live here?
I live in Toronto now.
Oh, you do. Nice to meet you.
You too.
Bye.
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 Thank you. Thank you.
And now I'm going to tell you my very favorite story. And it has to do with a trip that I took in 1952. And the trip was from Los Angeles to Rome to make the picture Roman Holiday. And I had a stopover in Paris for a few days, and the Paramount people who were producing the film asked me to do an interview with the great Paris daily paper, the Francois. They said, it'll be with a very up-and-coming young reporter. She's very young, she's quite beautiful, and she's extremely smart. I said, well, that sounds good. And where do I meet her? And they said, at a restaurant on the left bank. They gave me the name of the restaurant. We did meet, and we did have a wonderful talk for an hour and a half. And then off I went and went to Rome for 6 months to film the Roman Holiday and finished the picture. I had another assignment, which was to be in Germany, but I had a month off, so I went to Paris. Drifted around by myself for a few days, and then I began to think of some agreeable company, and I thought of that wonderful girl that I had met 6 months before. I called her at the newspaper, and I guess I got the city room. I said, Mademoiselle Veronique Passani, s'il vous plaît. He said, qui parle, who calls? I said, Gregory PECK. And I guess he picked up a microphone, something like this. And they had an amplifying system, and he said, Mademoiselle Passani, c'est Monsieur Gregory PECK. Au téléphone, pour, he's on the telephone for you. All the typewriters stop like that. And I heard her heels clicking along, and I thought, this girl's in a tough spot. I'll get it over with quickly. I'll make my pitch, and I said, let's have another lunch together. And she said, I said, do you remember me? She said, I remember you all right. Let's have another lunch together, I said. And there was a pause. And I said, why don't we go and have lunch together? Another long pause. I thought, I'm not doing well at all here. I'm not getting the message across here. And I said, well, I've got an idea. Let's go out to Longchamp. There's racing today. And we'll watch the ponies run around the track, and we'll have a nice lunch on the pavilion. And finally she said, well, all right, all right. So we did have lunch at the racetrack, and we had dinner that night, and we had lunch and dinner the next night. And a few weeks later, I said to her, you know, it took you a long time to make up your mind to have lunch with me. What was going on with you? Did you have another boyfriend, have work to do? Maybe you just didn't like movie actors. And she said, well, I was not going to tell you this, but she said, I had an appointment that afternoon to interview Albert Schweitzer. At the apartment of Jean-Paul Sartre. I said, well, you made the right choice, kiddo. Well, next New Year's Eve, we will have been married 43 years. Two wonderful grown kids we love dearly, Anthony and Cecilia, a super grandson named Zachary. And now I think I'll ask Veronique to come out and join me here.
Hello, brother.
Doesn't. What shall I? Shall I do une grande scène?
Yes.
Okay.
We've been thrown out of better places than this.
Well, it was such a wonderful, wonderful place because during the war, it was difficult to go anywhere. And so we used to go to the racing club on bicycles, exactly go up this way as we are doing the Champs-Élysées.
From here, Evan and Franklin Roosevelt?
Exactly, from there.
Yeah.
It looks so magnificent to me then. I'm curious to see what it looks like now. Maybe it will look not the same at all.
And you were a little swimming champion?
I was. I trained with Madame Berlioz. Ah, bon, maintenant je crois que c'est à gauche.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Gregory, you come out with me.
Oh, no. I don't want to get thrown out.
You get... She's going to be thrown out on her own, I see.
No, you go with her.
Gee, this is where I used to park my bike right here. Where is my bike?
Maybe it's still here.
Maybe we can find your old bike.
Voilà, c'est ici.
Is that where you were swimming?
That's where I was swimming. Yeah. That's where I learned how to swim. I learned here. They attach a belt. It was so humiliating. They attach a belt and we're like little tadpoles with a belt. And before we hit the water, we had to learn how to do like this in the air. You know, we were on a hook with a belt.
You blew.
Je l'avais mis en courant parce que j'attendais qu'elle me fasse.
Et tu veux être la marraine?
Je veux être la marraine.
And enough of the kissing, Charles.
Why? Because you two always kiss each other?
No, he always kisses Veronique.
Oh.
I love that.
Basta.
But I must be frank.
Basta.
I do love
her. Basta.
I would have liked to marry her.
Depuis le début.
Too late. Too late.
Le fils.
Hey, that's true. I'm very much in love with her for a very long time.
Close. I know.
Mais vous connaissiez avant, les deux, avant qu'ils se marient.
Il a toujours capté le cœur de Véronique,
ce
qui ne m'a jamais laissé l'ombre d'une chance.
Christophe asked if Jacques and I knew each other before you and I knew each other.
Absolutely not.
Not.
Unfortunately, because you wouldn't have got any chance.
Oh, you're modest. I like modesty in a president. It's a good... There are not very many presidents who are modest.
Moi, je veux être le parrain de la petite fille de Cécile.
Ah ben oui, avec Richard.
Avec Richard.
Avec Richard.
Avec Richard.
Première
nouvelle.
Première.
Christophe,
premier enfant.
They're a fine goat, and there is a nice piece of chocolate for you.
Those are Anthony's chocolates.
Well, they're serving a good purpose. If I ever get anywhere with this little memoir of mine, I have the title, The Goats in the Kitchen. And this is the goat and this is the kitchen.
Oh, Charlie.
Charlie has ideas of his own. I think he wants to go home. They want me in their kitchen, they feed me chocolates,
where
and they kick
that?
Me out. It's the life of a goat. Goodbye, Charlie. The quote that I've always been fond of, it was a quote from Carol Lombard,
who always said it takes 10 pictures to make a star, so that the audience accepts you over a period of time. They become accustomed to seeing you on the screen, and if they like you a little bit, they're looking forward to the next picture.
Well, we're going to ask you to join in now. Please feel free to ask me anything you want. I mean, you ask the questions you want, and I'll give the answers that I want. Now, up here.
Mr. Peck, do you have a favorite role?
Oh, sure. It's Atticus Finch, sure. Oh. That was my lucky day when Alan Pakula and Bob Mulligan sent me the book. And they said, I think this is something you're going to like. Well, I sat up all night reading the book. I could hardly wait till 8 o'clock in the morning to call them and say, if you want me, I'm your boy. And you've seen little Scout on the screen. And she was a delightful and lovable, adorable little girl. And now she's delightful and adorable, a big girl. And she's right here now. Mary, will you stand up?
I spent lots of happy hours with the Pecks, and it was wonderful during the making of the film. My father had to stay back in Alabama and run his company. And Veronique and Atticus were kind enough to invite me over to the house and play with Cecilia and Anthony on the weekends, and it was sort of a family thing. And it was wonderful because here, after all these years, we have this marvelous relationship. And he is Atticus. I still call him Atticus. I don't know what else to call him. So, yeah, it's wonderful.
Still call her Scout. Yeah. Now, over here, please.
Mr. Peck, is it true that Harper Lee gave you her beloved father's pocket watch?
She did. Mm-hmm.
At Santa Monica, the Academy Awards presentation, Sophia Loren happily presents Gregory Peck.
I remember hearing my name called out for the Oscar, and in a kind of a daze, I walked up the aisle. I was clutching the gold watch Harper had given me in one hand and Cecilia's rabbit foot in the other. So it was a nice moment. Now, up here, please.
Mr. Peck, when I was 13 years old, I saw To Kill a Mockingbird. And it was such a seminal event in my life that as soon as I saw it, I knew that I wanted to become a lawyer. But not only was it to me a movie about a lawyer, but it was also, more importantly to me, about a father. And when my first son was born, I named him Atticus, and I became a lawyer. Today, before I left to come here, across from my office, I took out of a frame an original To Kill a Mockingbird poster. And I was wondering if it's possible, if sometime that you could sign that for me. And I would add that it...
How about tonight? Well, you're invited backstage with your poster, and I'll be very glad to meet you and sign it for you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States and Mrs. Clinton.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the wonderful welcome. Today, we honor an extraordinary group of Americans whose daring vision and indelible contributions to arts and humanities have opened all our eyes to the richness, diversity, and miracles of the human experience. First, the National Medal of the Arts. 60 years ago, Gregory Peck abandoned pre-med studies for the sound stages of Hollywood. While he never practiced the healing art, his performances have helped to heal some of our country's deepest wounds. He has been a tireless advocate for the arts, serving on the National Council of the Arts as president of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. It's a great honor for me to present this award as a genuine fan of Gregory Peck. Thank you.
Come on.
Yeah. Thank
you. I'll have to hand it to you.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for the kind introduction. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
Say hello to Jack the next time you
come.
Congratulations, Dom.
They'll replace your medal. You'll get it soon, right?
Yes.
It's a big, heavy medal. It's got ballet dancers on it.
It's great.
We will see you. Okay.
All right. Goodbye. All right.
Guess it's about that time.
Gradually, I learned that the art of film acting really has a lot to do with thinking and feeling. That you don't have to signal your feelings and your thoughts. They register in the camera. You don't have to semaphore them out as you do somewhat in the theater. Sometimes I've thought that when you're acting well, playing a scene well, it feels effortless and somewhat detached. You're totally involved and yet watching yourself at the same time.
I think in the long run, what the audience enjoys is to see someone being themselves and being allowed to look inside someone. And I think the secret of film acting is complete candor with the audience, or when you let them see the real you. These things are very important to a film actor who's really a storyteller. We are salesmen of the story. People have often asked, if all of us really get in so into a role that we live the role. And my answer is, well, we try to live it all right between 9 and 6 in the movies and 8 and 10 in the theater. But speaking for myself, I hope that my family does not expect a different guy to be coming home every night. But occasionally you do get wrapped up. And there's one occasion, and it was with General MacArthur. I was on the set in Hollywood filming a scene with about 600 extras out front representing the Senate, the senators, and the congressmen. And I was delivering the famous Old Soldiers Never Die speech.
They just fade away.
And I got a call, 11 o'clock in the morning, from my wife, Veronique, and she said, I have found our dream house. I said, are we looking for a dream house? She said, well, from time to time, I have been, yes. But she said, you've got to get over here on your lunch hour, because I know a certain producer and his wife, and they're mad keen on this house, and they're probably going to wrap it up before the end of the day. So I had to go.
And I jumped in a car with a driver in the full MacArthur regalia with the scrambled eggs on his cap and the medals, and raced over to this place in a section called Holmby Hills. And I got over there and I strode out. I saw a fine Norman style house, seemed to be, and I saw a grassy slope leading down the hill, and saw a tennis court, and it looked good. And I saw Veronique, my wife, and the agent standing in the middle of the slope, and I looked it over, and I said, "Buy it." And I started walking off. And they ran behind and said, "Don't you want to see the inside?" I said, "We'll fix it." It was MacArthur talking. I got back to the studio, and still in an aggressive mode, I called my manager and I said, "Veronique wants this house. I want you to go after it. I want you to be aggressive." And P.S., that night, Veronique had her dream house. I would have dithered. It was all MacArthur, all MacArthur. So let's see. Now, here, please.
I wanted to ask you about Gentleman's Agreement. While it was being made, were you all aware that it had some impact, or was it a movie that was being made?
We knew that subject of anti-Semitism had not been treated on the screen before. Well, L.B. Mayer tried to get Zanuck to call it off. L.B. Mayer called him up and said, "Well, you know, we don't want to stir things up. 80 million people a week going to the theater in America before the advent of television, and we're doing fine, business is good, so why bring up a controversial subject?" And Zanuck said, "Well, I love telling a good story, and so does Greg, and so does Elia Kazan, who's going to direct it. So we're gung-ho, and we're going to make this movie." And it came out and won the Oscar and was a resounding success.
Tom, what is it? What's the matter? Did you have a fight? Argument with one of the guys?
They call me a dirty Jew and a stinking kite.
Oh, darling, it's not true. It's not true. You're no more Jewish than I am. It's just a horrible mistake.
Kathy! Come with me, Tom. We'll talk about it in a minute. Take it easy.
You really do think I'm an anti-Semite?
No, I don't, Kathy.
You do. You've thought it secretly for a long time.
No, it's just that I've come to see that lots of nice people who aren't, people who despise it and detest it and deplore it and protest their own innocence, help it along and then wonder why it grows. People who'd never beat up a Jew or your kike at a child. People who think that anti-Semitism is something away off in some dark crackpot place with low-class morons. That's the biggest discovery I've made about this whole business, Kathy. The good people, the nice people.
One thinks of films like Gentleman's Agreement or On the Beach or indeed To Kill a Mockingbird. But do you think of yourself as a socially committed actor?
Oh, I'm guilty of having a social conscience, all right. But I think of myself as an entertainer.
King Solomon could not have adjudicated more wisely, Your Honor. I am so offended by the Philistine tactics, Mr. Bowden. I petitioned the ABA for his disbarment on the grounds of moral turpitude. I felt that Scorsese's take on Cape Fear was a very interesting version. Some people prefer Scorsese's, some people prefer the one that we made about 1964. I like them both.
I would like to ask you about frightening times in making movies. Which was worse, those dogs in Boys of Brazil or Robert Mitchum trying to drown you in Cape Fear?
Well,
scene with Mitchum, he held me below the water in that swamp for quite a long time. But Mitchum's a pro. We had a signal. When I felt I'd been down long enough, I just rapped him on the lathe. Very seldom in actual physical danger. There was a scene in The Boys from Brazil when, in a terrible fight to the death that I had with Laurence Olivier, those dogs were set onto me, and they did me in. It was a bloody scene indeed. Actually, they're trained to retrieve, and the trainer, before a scene, he'll hold the dog behind the camera. He will walk in, and he'll say, "Fetch, fetch." And the dog knows that he's to go in and fetch my sleeve and bring it back to the trainer. The scene where he grabbed me by the throat, actually, the trainer went in and said, the knot in my tie, said, "Fetch, fetch." Well, that was all well and good, but I said to the director, "Why don't you do it first?" And he did. They're so well trained that I actually had no fear. And of course, the blood is artificial blood. Probably the nearest scrape that I ever had in my filmmaking career was Moby Dick. I nearly got killed out of the middle of the Irish Sea riding a rubber whale. The tow line broke and I got lost in a fog bank and in rough seas and sliding and trying to hang on to this beast. And if I let go of him, I won't know which way to swim. I was calling ahoy and come get me, things like that. Finally, they did find me, and a launch bumped into the whale, and I was so glad to get off of that rubber whale back into the launch. So, up here, please.
He was smiling in his sleep.
He's
having a pleasant dream. He's skiing down the slopes, although he does not know about skiing or about slopes, but he has a vivid imagination, and it has had from birth.
An Irish blessing, and I'll leave you with this. May you have food and raiment and a soft pillow for your head. And may you spend 40 years in heaven before the devil knows you're dead.
Thank you.
Doom, 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 doom